GO16 has generated a great deal of excitement in the operational forecasting community. However, its value for some critical warning and forecast decisions is impeded by one drawback, the effect of parallax. The good news is we can overcome this drawback by understanding its causes and then applying some simple mitigation techniques. Parallax is defined as the apparent displacement of an object due to differences in observing platform locations. For geostationary meteorological satellites, parallax is attributable to the angle between the satellite subpoint and the specific position of the target object. There are three factors that influence parallax associated with weather satellites in geostationary orbit: latitude, longitude, and the height of the feature above the Earth's surface. To visualize how these factors translate into parallax displacement, let's consider a conceptual cartoon. This is a simplified illustration of a spacecraft in the GOES-R series. Let's pretend the cartoon represents GOES-16, since that satellite is already in orbit. GOES-16, like any geostationary satellite, is positioned over the equator, orbiting at an altitude of roughly 22,000 miles, or 36,000 kilometers. Therefore, when the satellite detects objects located at mid-latitudes, it is viewing them at an angle, not from directly overhead. Additionally, the satellite sensor has no explicit information about the height of objects above the ground. It simply captures images and geolocates individual elements as if they are surface-based objects. Imagine a thunderstorm which has formed at 40 degrees north latitude, with a line of towering cumulus on its southern flank. For the sake of demonstration, let's say the cumulonimbus cloud is 15 kilometers in width at its base and approximately the same height above the ground. This thunderstorm is in a mature phase with a well-developed anvil and a strong, broad updraft that is supporting a 50 dBz reflectivity core aloft, as detected by a nearby radar. When depicted on a plan view map, the reflectivity core will be located accurately, directly beneath the position where the radar beam intercepts it. However, the corresponding satellite image will be displaced poleward. The distance of that displacement is a function of its height. Here's why. While GOES-16 detects the reflectance, or brightness temperature, of the thunderstorm top, it assumes that feature is at the Earth's surface. Therefore, rather than placing it below the back edge of a 50,000-foot structure, the satellite geolocates the feature as though it were positioned at the point where the beam intercepts the ground. That pixel will then be placed at this perceived position, several kilometers north of its true location. A similar displacement occurs in the longitudinal direction, that is, if a tall cloud feature is located to the west or east of the satellite's longitudinal subpoint, it will be positioned farther to the west or east, respectively, as a consequence of parallax. One final point related to the effects of parallax on thunderstorms. Because of the satellite's viewing angle and the spatial resolution of the spectral band, the equatorward side of the storm is partially visible, as well as its top. Thus, the image you observe is slightly stretched out and tilted from vertical. To further reinforce this concept, let's look at a real example. Here is a radar reflectivity image of a storm about 40 miles west of Topeka, Kansas. The date and time don't really matter because I'm just using this case to illustrate a point. The image depicts reflectivity along the 0.5-degree scan from the KTWX radar. The white line represents a northwest to southeast cross-section that cuts through the strongest portion of the updraft. Details about the storm's structure are more easily visualized in this vertical cross-section along that line. Reflectivity values are relatively low where the inflow is occurring near the surface, but higher reflectivities are suspended aloft by the strong updraft. In fact, there's even evidence of an overshooting top above the equilibrium level. Now let's superimpose the radar reflectivity on top of the corresponding image from the GOES-16 0.64 micron visible channel. Note that the overshooting top in the visible satellite image is displaced to the north and west of the location we just analyzed from the radar cross-section. This displacement is also clearly evident in the infrared, as seen here. The coldest cloud top pixel on the 10.3 micron, or clean IR channel, is placed north and west of the position where radar indicated the location of the main updraft. While these distances are not great, they are significant enough to impact certain operational decisions that require precision. For example, returning to our radar image west of Topeka, let's assume that after carefully interrogating reflectivity, velocity, dual pole products, and the near-storm environment, you have decided this storm poses an imminent tornado threat. Based on your determination that the storm will likely remain anchored to the proximity of the boundary, and accounting for some southeastward motion of that boundary over the next half hour or so, you generate this tornado warning polygon. Overlaying the corresponding GO16 visible image, we can see that the tornado warning does not encompass the areas where satellite imagery would suggest the highest severe threats are located. The overshooting top is completely outside the bounds of the tornado threat we identified on radar, and even the region of vigorous inflow is barely within the northern periphery of the polygon. For this very reason, some have concluded satellite is not a useful tool for convective warning decisions. However, we would argue for a different perspective. As long as you recognize and make adjustments for the effects of parallax, it is possible to use GO16 products, along with other observational data and predictive fields, not only to improve your situational intelligence, but to inform critical short-term forecasting decisions, even convective warnings. With practice, effective integration of high-resolution datasets can enhance a forecaster's abilities in many ways. Assessing the near-storm environment, anticipating rather than reacting to development, and in some cases, drawing or refining warning polygons while waiting for the next radar volume scan. In radar-sparse regions, forecasters are increasingly employing GO16 imagery as a crucial component to their convective warning decisions. This will likely become even more prevalent once the GO16 GLM data are operational. The key is to understand and account for the effects of parallax when using satellite imagery to determine and communicate specific threats. By learning and practicing a few simple techniques, forecasters can learn to make effective adjustments to the slight geolocation displacements produced by parallax. As your ability to make such adjustments improves, you may well find GOSAR series satellite imagery and derived products to be valuable tools that can enhance your situational awareness of the environment, increase the accuracy, quality, and timeliness of your forecasts, strengthen your confidence in those forecasts, and improve your communication with core partners who need your expertise to make effective risk management decisions.